Welcome to the final on the fly of the season. He's Ken Danico. I'm Erica Wachter. Six games on the slate as we celebrate the final day of the NHL regular season. But Dano, of course, only two of them truly had any meaning, and the ones we were watching, and they did not disappoint. It was a wild finish to the regular season and the race out west.
I thought no way in a million years the Vegas Golden Knights were going to lose at home to the Anaheim Ducks to change the first round matchups, but that's what's happened all year in the National Hockey League. That's what the unpredictable and a great last night. What a great season.
Yeah, the league full of surprises. So let's get you right to the highlights and show you how things went down in Vegas.
There are a couple of things to play for on the line tonight for the Vegas Golden Knights going into this one. So let's run it down for you. The result will influence the Western Conference playoff matchup. A win and Vegas will clinch third in the Pacific and lock up a rematch with the Oilers in the first round.
All the way back to the line and a one-time shot misses as Marchessault was covering the point. Hayden got it in front and a point-blank save on Eichel made by Dostal.
And there's that point-blank chance for Jack Eichel. And a real good initial stop from Lucas Dostal.
And Gauthier with a shot on and a save. Hill. That's the first shot of the game and the first shot of his NHL career for Cutter Gauthier.
Kept alive, and Dorofeev had it knocked off his stick initially by Carlson. Centering pass, and Barbashev is stopped by Dostal.
All right, Lucas made some real good stops on pucks that have been passed from behind the goal line to people in the slot.
Centers into the slot. Marchessault got it away. Another save by Dostal on the rebound. Marchessault got his own carom. Lucas Dostal keeping it scoreless in Vegas. Howden again sends it brink wide. Here come the Golden Knights to the front of the net. Goes Eichel, a fat rebound. Oh, Dostal with a wonderful save on the rebound on Marchessault, and he'll cover up. Boy, he made the initial save, but the save on the second shot was that much better, and we're still scoreless. Just over a minute remains in the power play. For the line, it's Fowler across. Petrano, one-timer, score! Off the glove and in, as Aiden Hill got a piece of it, but not enough. And number 35 for Frank Petrano makes it 1-0.
You know, this is option A for this particular power play unit of the Ducks.
Golden Knights on their second power play. Had four shots on their first. Here's Eichel looking. Feeds it to the middle, score! Marchessault on the
Marchessault right at the hash marks, and that doesn't, it's not Marchessault, that's Eichel's goal.
Nice little move there by Leo, opens some space, coming in off the point. Jackson Lacombe scores.
This is all about Leo Carlson. I mean, the deception that he uses to shed a couple of checkers, and all of a sudden, the Golden Knights are overloaded on one side.
Petrano into the zone, his shot score.
What a shot. Whoa. Frank Petrano, man, he is just feeling it. He comes down that left wing, and he just snaps that up into the top corner over the glove of Aiden Hill.
Killorn tries to go up the middle on the backhand. Hurdle picked it off. Lacombe sets it ahead, and into the empty net, Frank Petrano has another hat trick.
Unbelievable.
His sixth of his career and his fourth this season.
Came into the game with 37 goals on the season for Frank Petrano, and that is center cut, man.
Lucas Reichel with a step on the loose puck. Reichel, he scores!
It's how he flips it to himself, but watch the body right there, that little lean, and then the edge control. I mean, he blows a lot of snow there, right? Because he's changing direction so quickly. You don't like to see that happen if you're the Kings.
Arvidsson hands it off, and it's worked in deep by Deneau. Deneau chases down. Another Hawk lost his stick. Deneau with it. Deneau, nice move in the middle. Deneau hands it off. One-timer. Score! Victor Arvidsson from the left circle put it in down low off Soderblom. And the Kings have tied it at one.
And Deneau finds a way to hold on, hold on, hold on, and finally get it to the open Arvidsson.
Arvidsson fanned on the pass again, and a possible shorthanded chance for Vlasic and Blackwell. Vlasic for Blackwell. Dickinson.
Oh,
missed the net. Rebound, score.
Yeah, Talbot's saying it might have got kicked in.
So the first attempt does not work. Shot, rebound. He's trying to, it does go off his skate, I believe. Is he trying to corral it?
or is there a visible, distinct kicking? Well, that's tough to say.
After reviewing the play, the call on the ice is overturned. No goal.
Dubois, top of the slot, check. Hawks can't clear. Spence has to regroup. Spence moving to his left. Hands it off for Deneau. Centers, tick, score! Quinton Byfield! First goal in 20 games! And the Kings have a lead at 2-1.
And there's a little extra there, there's no question. Everyone knows. And he caresses it into the net. He redirects it into the net.
2:40 left, second period. And Deneau with a centering pass. Tipped, Moore scores! The line teams up again. Moore, Deneau, Arvidsson, 3-1 LA.
One touch, movement, and then unselfishness.
We have a tie game. Now it's Entwistle to the net, redirect, score! And the Hawks have the lead. Ryan Donato, who scored the first goal of the season for the Blackhawks.
1:46.
Net is empty. Chicago off the draw with...
Whoa, that's a penalty.
Chip it over the glass.
Penalty, automatic.
Doughty at the blue line for Kempe. Kempe holding at the goal line. Touch pass in front. Score! Victor Arvidsson! With 1:21 left in regulation, Victor Arvidsson's second of the night has tied the game at 4.
Byfield goes low. Arvidsson stays high.
Ahead, Byfield chips it in, and the Kings and Edmonton Oilers for the third straight season. And off the draw, Kempe quickly moves in. Kempe shoots and scores! That's the way to end the regular season. Overtime goal. Adrian Kempe, 6 seconds in. Kings win it.
It's hard not to think about the whole picture, I guess. So, I guess we knew... We kind of knew what the score was going out for the third period and all that stuff. Didn't plan on going down one goal, but, you know, I guess we got the job done in the end, and we're going back to Edmonton.
We're in the playoffs. You know, that was the goal at the beginning of the season. Every team that's left standing is a good hockey team. There's no easy path to winning, so... You know, we understand that. Every game is going to be a battle. I think we should be pretty excited. It's a great opportunity for our team.
So the stage is set for the Western Conference. The top-seeded Stars get the defending Stanley Cup champions, and some Central Division rivals square off as the Jets take on the Avs. The Canucks get the pesky Predators, and the Oilers take on the Kings for the third straight postseason. So, obviously, a little scoreboard watching that one. They were aware of their games, and it's the Kings who get the 2 points in a wild finish to the regular season. Those games that we were watching that mattered certainly proved to really count.
I guess only fitting, right, the way this season
exactly.
has gone where, I mean, I just didn't think that either of these teams were
Even
going
stunned.
To lose, and the Kings fell behind 4-3 in the third period and found a way late. And the Ducks, well, they took it to Vegas tonight and led by Frankie Vetrano,
mm-hmm.
Who was
sixth career Addy,
scoring every which way. You see the excitement, and they end on a good note. But it just surprised me, Eric, because I said before the night, I said, there's no way Vegas is going to lose tonight at home against the Anaheim Ducks, and they're going to be playing the Edmonton Oilers for sure. I believed, but...
you thought it was a done deal.
I thought it was a done deal, and I'm sure a lot of people did. But things went right down to the wire, and then we look at the L.A. Kings, Kempe in overtime, early in overtime, but they had to score a late goal just to tie that game up, or it would be different matchups, and that's what makes our game great, the unpredictable, and now Edmonton and L.A. meet once again. And, oh, what a gift for the Dallas Stars, having the best record in the Western Conference, and they get to meet in the first round the defending Stanley Cup champions. I mean, it Can't get any better.
Yeah, conference rematch from a season ago. But let's start with a familiar matchup we've seen now for the third straight season. You just said it, the Kings and Oilers will be squaring off. And obviously, this has not gone in the favor of L.A. So, you know, they win the game, but they think, oh, boy, we're right back to it because the Oilers superstars have just dominated this matchup overall. McDavid, 24 points in his 13 playoff games, and Draisaitl with 20 over that same stretch.
Yeah, just remarkable. I mean, 2 points a game, kind of unheard of. I know it's in only a couple of playoff series that these two teams have met, but saw those overtime games as well. Look, a lot of familiarity, but this time around, the Edmonton Oilers are much deeper, in my opinion. Everybody knows they've added more depth. Zach Hyman with a terrific year. Nugent Hopkins doing his thing. They add Adam Henrique, a veteran guy who's had a terrific season. Sam Carrick for that grit. And now we got to play the games. L.A., if you look at the Kings, I mean, they kind of went stumbling down the stretch. Mm-hmm. But you wipe the slate clean. They're hoping they can turn it on. They had the second best goals against in the Western Conference, so that usually bodes well. I mean, that kind of surprised me. I had to double check that, and I'm going, they gave up the second least goals in the Western Conference, which bodes well going into a seven-game series because they're going to have that mentality where things tighten up. Right. Not as easy to, you know, create offense. Everybody's paying the price. Everybody's doing all the little things at a little higher level, and that's what the Kings are going to have to do because they're going to have to somehow, some way, if they're going to win the series or have, at least have a chance, and Edmonton's going to be heavily favored, in my opinion, you can't have McDavid and Draisaitl do what they did
right
in the first two times these teams met the last couple of seasons. But like I said, you shut those guys down somewhat, you're not going to completely do it. I think the Oilers have a lot more depth scoring now that can help the dynamic duo out.
Well, definitely, you know, some question marks as you're going into this one and just kind of figuring out how you're able to slow the Oilers down. So if you talk about the net minding, especially as you're watching this L.A. game on this final night of the season unfold, where does your confidence lie there between the pipes?
Oh, your guess is as good as anyone's. I mean, that's taking nothing away. I know Talbot really started well, but still kind of a wild card, mm-hmm. right? How consistent is he going to be?
Sure.
And you can say the same thing for the Edmonton Oilers goaltending. LA is really going to concentrate on, in my opinion, and they were playing that pretty well the last 20, 30 games anyway, that really, you know, structured game and really play, you know, more of a conservative style of game. They're going to maybe have to do that come playoff time. A lot of teams do, by the way, mm-hmm. because we know the old adage, defense wins championships.
That's, you would know.
But both teams, that's the wild card here. Goaltenders don't have to be spectacular and stand their head, but they have to give your team a chance to win. And I would say there's question marks from both sides. Not that they can't play sure. outstanding, but that's what we have to wait and see. Which goaltender plays better, whether it's Talbot mm-hmm. or it's Skinner? And that's maybe a deciding factor.
All right, we'll see. Yeah, you know, goaltending's obviously just so huge in the playoffs, no matter if you're doing it by committee, like we see with some of these teams. Of course, Jake Oettinger for the Dallas Stars, he's been a big part, and he's had that real resurgence in his play of late. So he'll be taking on the defending champs, as you mentioned. They fall to face the team that's locked up home advantage throughout the West, and that is your Stars, who are so hot right now. So what's most intriguing about this matchup overall?
Well, they're meeting again,
yes.
And it was a terrific series last year, and Vegas closed it out relatively handily in Game 6 with a 6-0 shutout, I believe. But look, one thing I say, everybody worries about how you played down the stretch. Dallas played great all season long, mm-hmm. great down the stretch. So they're going to be going into the playoffs relatively confident. Vegas, they had won 3 in a row, then they lose to Dallas. But they've been kind of up and down the last 4 to 6 weeks. I don't think it matters for them. When you've won a Stanley Cup, and I speak from experience, you can turn the switch off and on. And they're going to turn the switch on because they're trying to defend their title. They're a deep team. They're going to get some reinforcements. We'll see if Mark Stone's back. Aiden Hill hasn't been quite as good as he was last year in the playoffs, where he took everybody by storm, and he was outstanding for them. So he's going to have to dial it up, or whoever they go with. I mean, Logan Thompson's very capable as well. But having said that, Dallas is poised and ready to knock off the champs, but it's not going to be easy. And Dallas is as deep a team as there is in the National Hockey League. Rely on all four lines. Everybody can score. Ottinger was a little bit up and down during the year. He's going to have to dial it in because we've known he has been one of the better goaltenders in the league the last handful of seasons. This year was a little topsy-turvy. But coming along, getting better. Yeah,
and that's right, the time right now.
He's hitting his stride at the right time. And we mention goaltending so often, Erica, because it is such a key. But it seems nowadays more so than, say, 15, 20 years ago, you don't have to stand in your head. You just have to make some timely saves and be competent.
Right.
Whereas we've seen in the past, it just seems to me more 15, 20 years ago where goaltenders won series single-handedly kind of deal. But this is going to be a terrific series. I can't wait because it's the defending cup champs you got to knock off in the first round. And Dallas has visions of going to the Stanley Cup Finals.
Yeah, I'm sure this is going to just be an epic series overall. And, yes, Vegas is getting some reinforcements back right in time for the postseason. And these two teams haven't even seen each other in several months. We'll get back to more of the games in a bit from the final day of the season. But we did have some major news. So let's get to that. That came on Thursday. The NHL's Board of Governors has approved the sale of the Arizona Coyotes and the establishment of a new franchise in Utah. The club will begin play next season at Delta Center in Salt Lake City. Our Adnan Virk was in New York Thursday and spoke with Commissioner Gary Bettman.
All right, Gary, congratulations. Obviously, a momentous day here for the National Hockey League. What were the biggest factors that led to the establishment of a new franchise in Utah?
Well, there were a lot of factors. It was a fairly complicated three-party transaction, but the goal was to preserve hockey to the extent we could in Arizona and establish a new franchise in Utah. So the Coyotes are going to be inactive, with the right to reactivate when a new building is built within the next 5 years, and the players and hockey operations are going to be shifted to Utah, and Ryan Smith and his partners are going to own and operate that, and the team will play in the Delta Center.
Right. And that's the key. It's the establishment of a new franchise. It's not a relocation. It's not an expansion team. Essentially, that's the way it goes.
It's really kind of a hybrid because we're taking a pause. We can get a new building there, but what really was underlying all of this was what we thought was going to be a temporary facility, meaning Mullet, and thank you to ASU for sharing the facility with us. We were looking under a best case at another 3 to 5 years. It wasn't appropriate for the league. It's not a major league building, and it wasn't fair to the players.
You mentioned the fact there'll be hockey at the Delta Center, 12,000 unobstructed seats, and perhaps plans to go further from that.
Well, actually, there are plans which I've seen, and it'll take 2 summers to do it after this summer, but the unobstructed capacity will be 17,000 when they're done, and while it's 12,000 unobstructed now, there's still another 4,000 for the temporary part of this obstructed seats.
Well, it's clearly been part of your legacy to have hockey in non-traditional markets. How nice is it going to be for hockey fans to see hockey in Utah?
Well, I think it's going to be great. It's a great winter sports area, so we're looking forward to going to Utah. Great for sports, great for winter sports, and we think NHL hockey will thrive there.
And what's your message to Coyotes fans? Like you said, that hopefully hockey will be there.
The plan is to come back when there's finally a new suitable building for the Coyotes.
And last thing, on the eve of the NHL playoffs, what are you most excited about when the playoffs begin Saturday?
There's nothing like our playoffs, particularly our first round. Can't wait to get started. And when you look at what happened this week, the end of the regular season, couldn't have been any more exciting.
It's always exciting down the wire. NHL Commissioner Gary Bettman. Thanks, Gary.
Thank you.
Guys, back to you.
All right, so Utah, they do have a rich hockey history. The Golden Eagles played in various leagues from 1969 through 94. The Grizzlies started in the IHL in 1995 and still compete in the ECHL. Salt Lake City hosted the 2002 Winter Olympics when Canada won men's and women's hockey gold. And also, Salt Lake City is the favorite to hold the games again in 2034. New Utah owner Ryan Smith joined NHL Now on Thursday.
Ryan, congratulations. A celebratory day for you and Ashley and the entire family and the city of Utah, or the state of Utah, I should say. I know that you're in Arizona right now. You just had the opportunity to meet some of your players. So what was that moment like for you?
Yeah, it's not your normal everyday moment. I mean, if you actually think about how this is working and what we're doing, it's super unique in sports. And I've got to compliment Gary and the NHL and also Morelos for coming up with a pretty creative solution to a statement said, a complex situation. And so Utah, we're incredibly excited to welcome everyone. And, you know, we're going to go build something together. And I think that should be super exciting for this team, for this new franchise that we're actually establishing, because, you know, everyone's going to look back 10 years from now and be like, I did that. I was there at that moment of time to establish this. And I think it's a pretty amazing opportunity. I mean, it's only been, what, 45 minutes? We already have 4,000 people who have put deposits on tickets. So it's coming.
That's incredible. And Jason Immers, former Coyote. And so, like I said, bittersweet for me. But my question to you is, why the NHL? What drew you and your wife to this league?
Yeah, so first of all, I'm bullish long term on where the league's going. I mean, just the profile, what's happening. There's no secret, the TV coverage. It's the last couple of years have been pretty amazing to watch that, specifically in recent times. And then if I look out, I mean, you look at our market in the NHL. I mean, we have a long hockey history. We've got the Olympics, hopefully, that are coming back that could be announced this winter or this summer in Paris. Almost every other Olympic sport is training in Utah year round. And we're up for it. We've had the Frozen Fury there where the Kings have played a bunch, and we get incredible crowds for people showing up. It's going to be a fun moment where everyone can come and rally around one of the hottest markets in the world right now.
Well, Ryan, we're learning more and more about you and your wife as far as, you know, we know that with the Utah Jazz, you got the MLS team, and you got a lot of different things going on. And I have this envision that you're going to be an owner. You're going to be like this Mark Cuban. Are you going to be like down on the glass for some of these games? Are you like a diehard fan of sports? Like, this is all, I mean, you're a progressive thinker. You're one of those exciting young owners in sports. This is at least where my mind's taking me.
You know, that a lot of people ask me that when we took over the NBA Jazz organization. It's like, what kind of owner are you going to be? And it's like, I'm Ryan. And Ashley, like, we are who we are. We built, you know, I ran Qualtrics for 20 years. I can't change that. We'll be hands-on. We'll be, you know, we'll be involved. But at the same time, like, our philosophy is, like, we'll be down to every detail, but we also want to hire amazing people and empower the hell out of them.
All right, so a new team is joining the NHL circuit. And coming up, Nathan MacKinnon entered game 82, 6 points behind Nikita Kucherov for the Art Ross Trophy. Highlights from Oilers and Avs season finale are next.
Another hat trick, another Hockey Fights cancer donation from AstraZeneca to the V Foundation for cancer research. AstraZeneca, redefining cancer care.
Welcome back. Nathan MacKinnon and the Avs were taking on the shorthanded Oilers in Colorado.
We will possibly see history made as Nathan MacKinnon shoots for points 139 and 140 to set the franchise record for points in a season. Now Arturi Lehkonen, backdoor one-timer. They shoot and score. It's Val Nichushkin. The 2-2 train pulls into the station. His second goal, his last 11 games. And not even 2 minutes into the first, it's 1-0 Colorado. MacKinnon has it again. Taves, backdoor for Rantanen, holding, shooting. He scores! The moose is loose! It should be a secondary assist for Nathan MacKinnon, and that means 139 points, which is tied for the most in franchise history.
The Avs will go to the power play.
Connor MacKinnon in front, tipped in! Nichushkin has his second of the period, and Nathan MacKinnon has made history. MacKinnon, 140 points, is the new standard in burgundy and blue. Nobody in the history of the franchise has more points in a single season than Nathan MacKinnon.
Nathan MacKinnon has just eclipsed 140 for the first time in franchise history. It's truly historical here. So lucky to be in the building to watch it.
Bounces through
Skinner. The point shot from Josh Manson. 4-0 Colorado.
That's blocked by Vogel, and now he'll let it go. Safe made by Eustace Onnen, and rebound is off the side of the net, and diving to his right is Eustace Onnen, and he makes the save. Is that Eustace or Superman? Truth, Eustace, and the finish way.
Broberg, shot, score! Tiptoed by Holloway from the slot. Dylan Holloway continues to shine since his recall from Bakersfield.
We have a new goaltender for the Edmonton Oilers, Calvin Pickard. Our staff of thousands fired up for it. Looking for the redirect. Onnen made the save. And we get a whistle.
That's a really nice save by Onnen.
Now the Oilers can't clear as Sean Walker stepped up and put Sam Gagner down on his backside out in front. They score!
Reach for the sky!
Miles Wood and Zach Parise are right there. So I guess it's easy, breezy, Zach Parise. In his final regular season game in his NHL career, Zach Parise. As career goal number 434, it's 5-1 Avalanche.
Jonathan Duran, we saw him go down at the end of that second period, go to the locker room early. I just got word he's not returning tonight with a lower body injury. Unclear if it's precautionary or just trying to bubble wrap him to the playoffs.
Warren Fogel's appreciated the elevation, and now point blank, stone twice, three times. Ryan tonight still loose and slipped wide. Just Eustace Onnen, and here's McLeod firing, and that ended up maybe ticking off the mask on its way out of play, but Eustace Onnen, and I'll tell you who's making a case for a potential playoff start or two.
Colorado will open at Winnipeg, 41 hours away to the Stanley Cup playoffs.
All right, so the Art Ross Trophy race has officially come to an end as Nikita Kucherov takes home his second trophy, 144 points for him. Nathan MacKinnon finishing second, still searching for that first Art Ross, but 140 points as he picks up two more in the first 8 minutes of that game there against the Oilers. And just what an incredible year, those home point streaks, the point streaks overall. He was just so much fun to watch in Colorado.
A remarkable season for Nate MacKinnon. He breaks a franchise, all-time franchise record for most points for the Quebec Nordiques, Colorado Avalanche with 140, breaking the great Peter Stastny's record. A guy who I played with was an incredible player, but what a year for Nate MacKinnon. Look at this pass in front and the nice little tip as Nichushkin gets good body position, chips it home, but just a tremendous season by so many guys that we've talked about. Nathan MacKinnon right there, we know, for the Hart Trophy is
right.
Best player in the National Hockey League, we are sure, but you could give it to a handful of guys, but he certainly had that kind of year.
Yeah, the battle for that, again, down the stretch. A lot of big decisions coming. It's the first time since the 95-96 season that we have two 140-point
scores. Unreal.
What a fun year. And we are just getting started here on the final night of the NHL regular season. After the break, it was a final tune-up for a couple of West clubs hoping to end Canada's Stanley Cup drought. Highlights from the Canucks and Jets are next. Welcome back to On the Fly. Brock Faber and the Wild were wrapping up their season against the Kraken.
Marc-Andre Fleury, who continues to shine, and he's earned himself a one-year contract extension.
And congratulations to Pierre-Édouard Belmar. 700 games in the National Hockey League as of tonight. So the first power play of the night. Flips it out in front. Kaprizov has it. Score! Number 46 on the season for Thrill, and Minnesota takes the early lead.
Get this puck in the hands of the difference maker. That's 97 in green.
Walked out on the backhand, and all of a sudden finding himself alone and centering one. Kicks it. Burakovsky off Eberle. That's the second time that Fleury has had a terrific save to take one away from Eberle. Alexiak allows his mates to tag up. Finds Tanev. Drops to Belmar. Kicks it by Fleury, and the rebound.
That's Levine. He got a stinger there. I'm not sure if that caught him off the fingernails on the glove side.
That's going to be Johansson to the box, so it will be Seattle to the power play. There's the wrister from Schultz. Score!
It looked like it may have been redirected out in front of Marc-Andre Fleury.
And credit Seattle here, because we were just lauding this penalty kill, and for good reason, of the Minnesota Wild. But for one split second, there's a rotation. The Wild can't recover.
Poked at by Ogren. Couldn't clear. Centering pass on net. And it went post to post off the one-time snap from Tolvanen. It got behind Fleury but drew iron and didn't end up in the net. And it will be a Minnesota power play. But he gets another breakaway. Yanni Gord moves in. Scores! The shorthanded goal for Yanni Gord.
Yanni Gord was worked on his hands about 2.5 hours before game time, and they certainly pay big dividends.
Here's a breakaway. Moving in, Zuccarello. Scores! Hit the corner, and we're tied.
Ooh! Is that ever sweet?
Behind the net, McCann back up top to Bjorkstrand. That drive. Scores! Was it deflected in front? It may have been by Ty Cartier. Faber blocks it. Here's Yanni Gord. His second breakaway goal, and that's about as easy as it gets. 6-on-4 continues after the timeout. Faber, wrist shot, score! There's one that Minnesota needed. 1:04 on the clock. Kaprizov, one more try. That's blocked by Beniers. And in game 82, Seattle wins it 4-3.
Welcome to game number 82. Can't settle it down. Gets it back though. Turn to shoot. Another chance. Let it go. Scores! Adam Kleppner's first National Hockey League goal. And it's 1-0 to Calgary.
Oh, I love the celebration. What a moment for Adam Kleppner.
Late stages power play. Now it's over. Anderson put that on goal. Rebound is there. And they score.
He deserves that. What a great moment for Coleman.
Fed across. Now Shillington with a shot. Scores! Seeing eye knuckle ball by Oliver Shillington makes it 3-0 Calgary. So Shillington should be awarded his third goal. Now Rooney with a shot. Scores!
That's his third goal of the season. And the Flames are up 4-0.
Parramanov feeds it over to Uyghur. Shoot! Scores! That should be number 20 for Mackenzie Uyghur. He rips it home and makes it 5-0. He'll pass to Zetterlin, shoots, and scores! Fabian Zetterlin with 8.9 seconds to go. His 24th of the year. Granlin will get an assist. And no shutout for Dustin Wolf on this night. The Flames steer home a 5-1 win. Season. So the Flames to center ice to salute the crowd here at Scotiabank Saddle Dome in the final game of the season. That opens the door for Brad Lambert to make his NHL debut, and his fellow freshman Nikita Chiprikov will also play his first Jets game.
Number 90 for Winnipeg, Nikita Chiprikov.
He and Mark Bolzing played together over the KHL a couple of seasons ago.
Joshua, it's in. It deflected in off Connor Garland as Dakota Joshua sent it cross crease. And I think it might have been a clearing attempt that ricocheted in off Garland to make it 1-0 Canucks.
Lambert bumped by Myers. Susie digs in. Here's Vilardi. Waits. Scores. Gabriel Vilardi with his 22nd. And we're tied at 1.
When Vilardi scores, the Jets don't lose. And Brad Lambert, as we just talked about, Ross and Kelly would be extremely proud as their son gets his first ever NHL point. A nice, safe little play, a mature play as he cycles it down low.
Brian Linetis Kapari. Here's Perfetti. Scores! Cole Perfetti with a beautiful wrist shot. His 18th gives the Jets the lead. So Perfetti taking that pass from Appleton. Nice finish from Cole Perfetti.
Patterson back to Myers. Left point, Soucy. Good pressure here from the Canucks. Soucy off the post. Hoglander tipped that one, and it hit the post and stayed out. And the Canucks, with all that pressure, unable to beat Lorne Brossoit into the net.
See if the Canucks can come together here on the power play. And
Hughes, wrist shot, tipped in.
And Hughes is going to put this through. There's the high tip. Goes past Joshua, bounces past Brossoit. And Lindholm, like his first game as a Canuck, had two power play goals with deflections, gets one in this game.
Jeff Cole has to be careful. He gave it away to Chiprikov. And he sweeps at it. Now behind the net. He don't need a runner. Chiprikov scores! There it is, the first NHL goal for Nikita Chiprikov.
This is an outstanding goal. This play happens because of Chiprikov getting up the ice, getting on the forecheck. Well, he jars the puck loose and then receives a brilliant little pass from below the goal line. Demko looking over his shoulder and quickly looking over his other one into the back of the net as Chibrikov on his toes gets up the ice and gets his first ever National Hockey League goal.
There goes Thatcher Demko. Hughes, back door, picked on. Perfetti scores. Paul Perfetti makes it 4-2 Winnipeg. So 19 goals for Perfetti in a season where, as it went on, he had a hard time getting ice time. And the Jets finished the regular season with 8 wins in a row. They beat the Canucks 4-2.
The slate is set for the Western Conference on Sunday. Central Division rivals Colorado and Winnipeg will battle it out up north, and Nashville will head to Vancouver for their second meeting in the postseason. It is time now for the Top Shelf Plays from Thursday.
McCann flips it out in front. Kaprizov has it. Score! Number 46 on the season for Carell the Thrill. And Minnesota takes the early lead.
Watch the agility to Edgeworth. Get this puck in the hands of the difference maker. That's 97 to Green.
Lucas Reichel with a step on the loose puck. Reichel, he scores! Lucas Reichel, a dazzling play.
He was off to the races. Backhand, forehand, backhand. Thanks for coming. What a play that is right there.
Recently, Middlestad gets second chance. Blackett and fire. Tic-tac-toe. Now Nichushkin. 1:18 in.
As Lekkonen goes back across to Val Nichushkin, it's like a passing drill.
Brodin across. Save the card. He took one away from Kaprizov.
And this is shades of the great Ken Griffey and also the great Ichiro out in Seattle. Maybe A-Rod will throw him in there too. Outstanding stuff there by Joey Decord.
You don't need a runner. Chibrikov scores!
Looking over his shoulder and quickly looking over his other one into the back of the net.
Welcome back to On the Fly. The playoffs begin Saturday with a pair of Eastern Conference matchups. At 5, the Hurricanes host Game 1 against the Islanders. Then at 8 Eastern, we've got Toronto taking on Boston. All right, so we're excited. Final night of the regular season. All eyes are on this weekend as the playoffs get underway. So let's do a little previews of those first two games, and we've got to begin.
Don't make me make predictions.
Okay,
Erica.
I know I you don't stand. Like predictions, especially when you think everyone can win this
yes.
year. I won't put you on the spot, I promise. But let's just talk about maybe these teams, and I won't ask you who's coming out of these series, but just in general how they match up. So the Canes, obviously, they've gotten the playoff experience, but they're trying to just take it to that next level.
You get think over that pieces, proverbial hump.
Exactly.
Be a contender.
Jake Guentzel, guys like that, are those additions that they have? What's going to help them get there with the scoring?
It gives them way more depth. There's no question about it. If there's one area over the last handful of playoffs where Carolina has struggled at times, it's finding that big offensive play, that big goal. Jake Guentzel can provide that. Kuznetsov.
Right.
Maybe not the player he was when he was terrific in the playoffs and won the Stanley Cup with the Capitals in 2018, but he seems healthy, he seems motivated, and he's a very skilled player. So those two guys in particular just make him that much deeper. Svechnikov is healthy, and he's going to be, you know, a key to this team, I believe, because he's that big, burly type player. But look at the forward line. Four lines here. I mean, every line can contribute offensively. We know they play an in-your-face style. They play a game where they just don't give you a lot of room to maneuver. Mm-hmm. And it's not just their defensemen, because
right.
they got a good core group of six. It's how the forwards play, and they're relentless on the forecheck, and they make it difficult on their opposition. So we will see. Is it Carolina's time? They've been terrific all season long, but they've added some pieces that they think can push them over the edge.
Yeah, Jake Guentzel already been huge, 25 points in 17 games with the Canes. But this Islanders team, they played well down the stretch to get themselves into the postseason. And obviously you can't overlook that. Look no further on a very different Florida Panthers team a season ago. But you look at their goaltending. This is where you give them the edge in this series. So that's going to be a challenge for Carolina.
I do, even though Freddie Anderson was absolutely terrific once he was healthy.
Right.
His numbers were off the charts. So, but you have to give the edge to this duo. Now, I'm very intrigued. Who do they start? We know Varlamov's kind of the guy down the stretch that really gave them that push and was terrific. Sorokin was a little bit up and down, but He has been one of the best goalies in the National Hockey League for many years now. So who do you start? For me, Patrick Roy has a little more comfortability, I believe, with Varlamov right now. So that's going to be really intriguing come Saturday, see who they start in goal. And the consensus is, for the most part, we always say it, nobody wants to face the New York Islanders if they get in.
Right.
Because they're just built more for a seven-game series, grind-it-out type game. And that they'll win 2-1, they'll win 3-2. They find ways to win hot games. Do they have the offensive power and depth of Carolina? No, they don't. But they got guys that can score. Brock Nelson, Kyle Palmieri carried a lot of the load. Key for me, if the Islanders are going to upset Carolina, because it would be an upset, Matthew Barzell's got to produce. He's got to be the Matthew Barzell, the engine, the motor going, making plays, scoring some timely goals. He's been a little quiet down the stretch. Picked up some assists, but they're going to need him to be the top scorer like he was during the regular season and make a lot of plays.
But again, it is a new season that starts, so perhaps he will do just that. We talked a little bit about the goaltending edge that you felt the Islanders had well in this next series. Of course, we got to talk about the Bruins at Netmind. Talk about tough decisions to be made. You got Linus Ullmark, Jeremy Swayman. I'm sure there'll be a lot of goalie hugs, what they're hoping for. But this is a big decision, too, for them. And, you know, you can roll with either.
It is. Great problem to have. Great tandem. Yeah. Jim Montgomery's talked about, well, we're going to do what we did in the regular season, and you know, we're going to rotate during the playoffs, and maybe they will. But I would suspect they go with Swayman to start the series. Who knows, though? We'll find that out. But both guys are going to play. That's a different mentality. We've seen that over the last few years, and they got two capable guys that are terrific. Look at the numbers. I mean, it says it all. 915 save percentage Ullmark, 916 Swayman. So they feel pretty comfortable whoever they put in there.
And I'm sure that's dangerous, too, just being able to have either go in terms of scouting in an everyday series like that. So the Leafs on the other side, they are another team that's trying to just take it to that next level, and they finally got past round one. But how do they go further? So they got some grit. They've acquired some grit to their team. Guys like Max Domi, Tyler Bertuzzi. Is that enough?
Well, if you look at the goal differential during the regular season, Boston was plus 43, Toronto plus 40. Toronto scores a few more goals. They're the top team as far as goal scoring in the league.
Austin Matthews.
And Boston's a little better defensively. They keep the puck out of their net. So what's going to give in this series? I know Boston has had Toronto's number over the years, but that's all behind you. I mean, now Toronto looks to kind of go against the Bruins here and upset them. It wouldn't be a huge upset. The Leafs got to take the next step, but they've added Bertuzzi. They've added Ty Domi. Max Domi. Ty, I used to fight Ty Domi. Still in my mind.
He's always there
punches
at the game.
But
so
Max, who's fairness. Been terrific for him, and they've played very well with a line of Austin Matthews. So can these guys be different because they bring a little more grit, a little more hunger around the net, things you need in a seven-game series in the playoffs? Leafs are going to have to tighten up their goaltending. Samsonov was really good for a long stretch after coming back from everything that the turmoil and adversity he went through and put on waivers in December and played terrific. And now the last handful of games, it's not been quite as stellar, quite as good. Can he get that back in the playoffs? Because they're going to need it, because you know Boston's goaltending is going
to
be good.
Yeah, well, we'll see. We'll have to wait long for that. Again, it's coming Saturday. And, of course, goal scoring, that's part of the year of magic that it was in the National. When we return, we'll look back at the best moments and put a bow on the 2023-24 season. That's next.
We made it. The excitement, the buildup. Yeah. This one has a different type of special feeling.
Hockey is back. No performance last year was better than that of the Vegas Golden Knights. They will celebrate their Stanley Cup championship.
Austin Matthews celebrates a milestone.
Connor Bedard making his NHL debut.
And he scores! Connor Bedard, first National Hockey League goal!
Somebody get that puck!
And welcome to the Frozen Frenzy. Every team in action tonight.
Ready to take the Battle of Alberta outside the Flames and Oilers in the Heritage Classic.
The NHL Global Series happening in Sweden. So many Swedish players are representing their country.
A sweet finish for the Maple Leafs.
25th season of Hockey Fights Cancer.
Hockey is built on great tradition and names that remain timeless.
and will never ever change. We're excited to honor and relive their incredible careers tonight.
It's all about the Hughes brothers. We and Jack and Luke playing the same NHL game for the first time.
More than 300th time in his career, Nathan McKinnon finds the back of the net. The Mac Attack is back.
The Winter Classic, Vegas and Seattle.
Happy New Year. There is no place we would rather be.
Hockey Outdoors with the first Winter Classic shutout.
Dave Hextall's cracking with a 3-0 planking of the Vegas Golden Knights.
Well, the halfway point of the NHL season is officially here.
All the feels from Toronto All-Star 2024. This truly is a very special place for hockey.
We're here to put on a show, and I hope the fans enjoyed it.
I know I did.
Team Matthews gave the people here in Toronto what they wanted.
The MVP is Austin Matthews.
I mean, just to play in front of 80,000 fans like the football guys do all the time, baseball out of the time, it's just such an incredible experience. So unique.
Nico Hischier with a backhand. He scores just 32 seconds in.
Here's Matt Rippey, NHL debut. Hello.
Wow, a fight before they even dropped the puck.
And it's in the net with a count. It crossed the line.
We have a good goal on the ice.
What a comeback.
Skating in his 1,000th NHL game.
It is incredible to play that long, that many games.
But the game was the secondary story, and the fans are going to stick around here as the Coyotes salute the crowd and do the post-game festivities.
You're going to have to drag people out of this rink. I'm pretty sure about that. It's gut-wrenching. Absolutely heartbreaking.
That's 100 on the season for Connor McDavid.
It's under feet of Rogers Place.
Austin Matthews has hit 69. It's never sounded so sweet.
But how good is Nikita Kucherov, huh?
There it is! 100 assists, Nikita Kucherov!
The fifth player in NHL history with 100 assists in a single season.
What a year for the New York Rangers. And for the fourth time in Rangers history, they have won the President's Trophy.
Oh, man, how good is that, Dano? Just looking back on the season.
What a great year.
What a great year is right. It's hard to just pin it all down, but I think our team did a really great job getting those 3 minutes to some of those milestone moments, so many great things that we can take away. So what are the biggest things you'll remember about this 2023-24 campaign?
Well, just the push last couple days of the season, in particular in the Eastern Conference, where four teams fans are on the edge of their seat. And yep, right there, T.J. Oshie punches the Washington Capitals ticket to the playoffs. And that was something nobody expected. I mean, they were minus 37 on the year, but it doesn't matter now. You wipe the slate clean.
That's right.
We haven't seen that, I don't think, too often, that big of a goal differential and make the playoffs. And then, guys, the terrific years we talked about. I mean, 100 assists from McDavid. And we didn't talk as much about him, because we talk about him a lot, because there was other guys doing great things like Matthews and McKinnon, and this guy Kucherov with his 100th assist last night as well. But
only five guys in the NHL and two this year, right?
And McDavid, we're getting used to McDavid doing some incredible things, right? And he's won the Art Ross Trophy so many times. And this guy, Austin Matthews, we all were on the edge of our seat.
All
hoping and praying he got his 70th goal, because it is such a milestone, such a feat that not many players in the history of the game have done. He took 12 shots last night, so it wasn't from a lack of trying. He hit a crossbar, but what a year for him. And I am a believer, you know, whatever happened, he's going to move forward. And, you know, it happened for a reason, that he didn't hit 69, because maybe he's going to do something special, even more special, that the Leafs need to win come playoff time.
Yeah, you know what? All any player cares about is hoisting up that cup, and that is the season that we're entering right now. After the regular season was one to remember, our awesome crew did it again. Another great year of On the Fly for Ken Danico. I'm Erica Wachter. We'll see you in the playoffs.